Once again, welcome to all the members of White Army for this continued session of epignosis, national level surgery, short clinical case presentation. We have about 26 participants in the final. Out of 170 students applied, we have selected 28 students for the short case category and 22 for the long case variety. So yesterday we had about 18 students participating in the finals. Today we will be continuing with the remaining 10. So first we shall start with Ms. Thirumagal, who is a fourth year student from Coimbatore Medical College. Before that, I would like to once again welcome our mentor and patron of White Army, who is ever source of motivation and inspiration for us, Professor Dr. Srinivasan sir from Coimbatore College. Welcome
thank
to you, sir.
Thank
and
you
also,
very much.
As a judge, we have our own again a very active member and also a budding surgeon, Dr. Chandana Shri, who
thank
did her MS from prestigious Mysore Medical College. And after her SRship, now she is currently preparing for MRCS and also MCH. So you will come to know about her in the due course of the presentations. So I will not tell much about her.
Thank you for having me,
thank
sir.
Thank you so much for being with us today. So let's start with Ms. Thirumagal. All the best.
Sir. A very good afternoon to respected judges, mentor, and each and everyone present here. I am Thirumagal, studying in final year MBBS in Coimbatore Medical College, and I'm here to present a surgery case. This is the picture of the case I'm going to present, sir. Summary of history. A 37-year-old gentleman who's a construction worker by occupation came to CMCH with a left-sided painless scrotal swelling, which started from below upwards. Was insidious in onset, was initially small, which gradually progressed to the present size in the past 10 months. It was not associated with trauma, fever with chills and rigor. The swelling doesn't reduce in size on lying down or increase in size on coughing. There was no history of sudden increase in size of the swelling, loss of weight and appetite. There was no history of any other swelling and no past history of any surgeries, tuberculosis, filariasis and STD. I think it's probably a case of left-sided hydrocele, sir. A general examination. After getting an
informed... Okay, next slide. Okay, the relevant things are there for all the participants. In general examination, not only if it's relevant to your case, only then mention. Otherwise, you can directly go to the local examination, okay? So that we can get more time for discussion.
Local examination of scrotum. After explaining the procedure to the patient and getting consent, the patient was adequately exposed from nipples to the knees, and the local examination was done with patient in standing position in the presence of a male attender. Inspection, left-sided scrotal swelling, globular in shape, extending from root of penis to base of scrotum. The skin over the scrotum appears stretched with mild loss of rugosity. There's no redness over the swelling. No scars, sinuses, and ulcers were present. Penis is in midline. There was no increase in size on coughing. Size doesn't reduce on lying down. Abdomen and inguinal region appears normal. Right side was normal, sir. On palpation, infection findings were confirmed. There was no local rise of temperature, no tenderness. Swelling measures about 8 into 6 into 5 centimeters. Was able to get about the swelling at the root of scrotum and feel the cord structures. Swelling was cystic in consistency. Fluctuation test was positive. Transillumination test was positive. Left testis is not palpable separately from the swelling. Cough impulse was absent. Swelling is not reducible. Normal left cord structures was palpated. Right side of the scrotum was normal. Lymph node examination, no palpable inguinal lymph nodes. Systemic examination, all this, there was no significant findings in it, sir. Provisional diagnosis. A 37-year-old gentleman presented with a left-sided globular swelling, which started from below upwards, which was insidious in onset, gradually progressive for the past 10 months, and is currently measuring 8 into 6 into 5 centimeters. It's a painless, non-reducible scrotal swelling, which is not associated with trauma and fever. On local examination of left scrotum, I was able to get over the swelling and feel normal cord structures. The swelling was cystic in consistency, fluctuant, trans-illuminant, and the testis was not palpable separately. This is probably a case of left-sided primary vaginal hydrosis.
Great, great presentation. Good start. So do you have any DDs?
So it could be a large epididymal cyst, sir.
Very good, very good. Then? Anything else? So why? What are the points? Why you think it's hydrocele only? Why not hernia?
So because
But.
Okay, so I was able to get over the swelling, sir, and then.
But yeah, you put a photo. Is that the way to do get over the swelling? You did with the it's a left sided swelling. Which hand you used?
Sir, I used right hand, sir. I was standing on the right side of the patient, so I used the right hand.
How do you do? For a left sided, you should stand on the left side and use your right hand from below.
Yes,
sir. I think you are holding from the above. I think no.
Please go back to the image.
Yes, sir. It was on left side only, sir.
Yeah, from the left side, using the right hand. That looks like you are holding with the left hand from above like this.
Okay.
Okay, no, I'm not mentioning the mistake, but the commonly from the right-sided swellings, we do with the left hand from the sitting below the patient with the left hand. For the left-sided swelling, we do with the right hand with the thumb front. You're right, but you know, it looks right. But your approach is okay, can be changed. Okay. And what are other things?
It was brilliantly trans-illuminant, sir.
Okay.
It was cystic in consistency.
Okay.
A fluctuation test was positive, sir.
Okay.
And a testis was not palpable separately, sir.
Okay. So, how did you do the trans-illumination test here?
In a dark room. The illuminoscope was kept anteriorly, sir, and the light was from a lateral position, sir. And through the illuminoscope, I saw whether it was transillumination, sir.
Okay. In which case you will not get not transillumination positive in case of hydrocele? It's a cystic swelling. It's hydrocele.
When there's an infection in pylocele.
Very good.
Pylocele. Yeah.
And then if it is a secondary hydrocele and
what is for primary, what is secondary?
So primary is idiopathic, sir. Secondary has a predisposing condition to it, sir. Primary will usually be large and tense.
No. What are secondary causes?
So some of the causes are epididymorchitis, a testicular tumor.
Yeah.
And then syphilis.
Okay. I say this is in Tamil Nadu. No, patient from Tamil Nadu. It's an endemic. I say it's filariasis. How do you agree with me or not?
Sir, it was a transilluminant, sir. If it's filariasis, it might be a chylocele might be there. So it
okay,
might.
Okay, one thing. Then, any other important point?
I had no history of periodic fever.
Okay, one thing. And for examination.
No tenderness, thickness in terms of spermatic.
Yeah, cord structure will be thickened and painful, tender. Tender in thickened in case of filariasis. Whereas in normal this thing, it will be not there. Did you examine the abdomen?
Yes, sir.
Why? What's the importance? What do you look for?
If it's a testicular a tumor, there might be a secondary retroperitoneal lymph node enlargement, sir.
I say this is varicocele.
Okay, sir.
I say this is a varicocele.
So, but it doesn't reduce on lying down, sir.
Okay, good. And then?
And there's no dragging pain.
Okay.
Transilluminant, sir.
Okay. How it feels like? Varicocele on palpation.
Bag of worms. On palpation, it will feel like bag of worms, sir.
And what are cough impulse?
Cough impulse, you can feel a thrill, sir.
What's the difference between herniaal cough impulse? Here, why did you do for cough impulse here in this case? What are you looking for?
Yes, sir, to rule out hernia and.
Hernia? Just scrotal swelling. Can hernia be just scrotal swelling?
No, sir.
Vice versa. Can hydrocele be inguinoscrotal?
So hydrocele can be inguinoscrotal, sir.
When?
What do you call the hydrocele which is inguinoscrotal?
Infantile.
Very good.
Excellent.
Then there are 3-4.
Congenital.
Very good. Funicular.
Funicular, sir.
And bilocular. Bilocular, encysted
hydrocele and bisect.
One more very important. Hernia, always, if there is a hydrocele, always look for a hernia along with this. Okay, most of the times hernia and hydrocele will be
coexisting.
Okay, always. So, what's the treatment for this?
So, the treatment for this is surgical only, sir, as it's a large swelling. And I would.
It was smaller?
Sir, if it is.
The size
not
actually
disturbing. If it is not disturbing, no treatment is required.
No, depending on the size, you have different surgeries. Okay.
Yes, sir. If it's small, it's a large plication, sir. If it's large, it's double-sized procedure.
Okay. Can I just, I'm not interested in doing surgery, Thirumagal. I'm tired and bored of doing so many, lords and what a jabula is and this thing. Can I just put a syringe and drain the fluid out? Yes, it's just like a serous collection, no? Can I drain it out with a 10cc syringe or some?
No, sir. It might lead to complications like hematocele and pylocele, sir. So, it will worsen the condition.
Recurrence chances also there. Unless, what you do in the surgery, you're not just draining out the fluid. Along with that, what you will do?
The
important step in surgery.
Eversion of the sac.
The sac. Very good. Otherwise, there will be high chance of recurrence. Ms. Chandana, Mrs. Chandana?
Yes, sir. Right here. If you encounter a hydrocele in a patient with a testicular swelling, what is your next step in management?
It would be to confirm whether it's a testicular swelling by ultrasound tumor markers, and then stage the
okay, we haven't come to the diagnosis yet, but yeah, there's a patient with an enlarged left testicle in addition to a hydrocele. So, what would you do next? You said you would do an ultrasound, right? Okay, so the ultrasound shows a lesion that is suspicious for testicular tumor. How would you proceed?
I would do the baseline investigations, ma'am.
What would you not do?
Aspirate or take biopsy, ma'am.
Excellent. Why not? Why shouldn't you do it?
Because there's a term.
You're very right. I'm actually very happy that.
How do you palpate for testis, Thirumagal? What are the parts of testis you palpate? How do you palpate? Order?
So, first, testis, sir, then a tunica vaginalis, an epididymis,
very good.
And heart
very
structures, good. And then superficial rings.
Wonderful. So, nothing more to ask, I think. Chandana, she has
prepared. Yes, she's excellent, sir.
excellent. Mm. Okay, mm. Wonderful presentation and answering very style. Good. Yeah, the way you answered so nicely, composed, you didn't hurry. Okay. And you thought well before. That's important. Some people know. They know the answer and just blur it out. Okay. So that's not the way. You should think for a while. Because once you utter the answer, no, you can't take it back. However much or sorry you tell, it's not acceptable. This is the way. Correct. You should think for a while. Then you should know what you're telling. Then answer. Proper. You answered everything. I can give you out.
Perfect. No, I mean, yeah, that's good. To all the presenters, I'll tell you. First, listen to the question of the
completely.
Chandana said, now it's a confirmed testicular swelling with hydrocele. Now, what will you do? Means you should go on straight away for the treatment. That is what she is asking. So, you cannot again, so I will do that one, this one. She asked, it is confirmed testicular swelling, testicular malignancy. So, I said, all the presenters first listen to the examiners. What
and understand what examiner is trying to ask. You can take time. No hurry. Nobody will ask you, expect you to answer immediately. Okay. Take 5 seconds of time. understand what examiner is asking and tell it briefly and straightforward. Okay, don't try to explain the examiner things. Don't try to explain them. Okay, very good. Thirumagal, okay, you have a bright future. Become a surgeon, okay? Become surgeon only. Don't take any other branches. Okay, thank you so much. Next, do you have Monisha ready?
Yes, sir. You stop mine so I can share. The slide visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. We can see the slide.
Sir, I'm audible, sir.
Monisha, yes. Can we see you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, please start.
Okay, sir. Good evening to all. Summary of my patient, a 55-year-old male working in petrol bunk with chief complaints of prominent dilated veins in left leg for past 1 year, pain in left lower limb for past 6 months, with hyperpigmentation of left ankle for 6 months. He is known diabetic for past 8 years and is a chronic smoker for past 30 years with no history of prolonged immobilization. Probably a case of varicose vein of left leg.
Hmm.
So next one. Examination of left lower limb. After getting proper consent with adequate privacy and adequate light, patient exposed from umbilicus to toe and examined in standing position. Inspection on standing position, dilated elongated vein seen over the medial aspect of left lower limb extending from in front of medial malleolus and runs upwards along the medial aspect of leg up to medial aspect of upper one-third of the thigh. Localized swelling seen above the medial malleolus, absence of dilated veins over the posterior aspect of leg. On elevation, dilated veins disappear, hyperpigmentation of the skin over the left ankle seen. No ulcers, scars, scratch marks seen. No loss of hair or brittleness of nails. No loss of subcutaneous fat. On palpation, not warm, not tender. Broadly Stendhal-Enberg test 1 and 2 is positive. Multiple tourniquet test. Dilated veins appear below the knee and perforator incompetence present. Figgins test positive. Modified Perthes test negative. No regional lymphadenopathy. Right limb examination is normal. All peripheral pulses are felt. Next, sir.
Okay,
other
fine,
system
next.
Examination normal, sir. Diagnosis: primary varicose vein of left lower limb involving great saphenous vein with saphenofemoral junction incompetence and ankle below knee perforator incompetence with hyperpigmentation of the skin. CEP classification: C4A, EPAS plus PR.
Good. Can you please explain that CEP classification to me?
Sir, CEP classification based on clinical, etiological and anatomical pathological classification of varicose vein. Clinical consists of 0 to 6 grade.
No. I want your diagnosis. Explain me your diagnosis.
4A. Yes, sir. 4A means skin changes present, sir. Hyperpigmentation.
Hmm.
Etiological classification is a primary one. Hmm. Anatomical, superficial and perforators.
Hmm.
And pathological reflex.
How do you say it's primary?
Sir?
How do you say it's primary?
Sir, etiology? It doesn't have a secondary causes like iliac vein thrombosis, any abdominal tumors.
How do you know there is abdominal no iliac vein thrombosis?
Sir, he didn't say any history.
He doesn't have a thrombus inside iliac vein.
Yes, sir.
No, how do you say? No, it's a clinical evidence. Yes, did you examine the abdomen?
Sir, yes, sir.
Hmm.
No abdominal mass.
Okay, if the patient had an iliac vein thrombosis, what are the telltale signs that you can see on the abdominal wall, if it is there?
Where you'll get the engorged veins?
Sir?
Okay.
There is a
Monisha?
Iliac vein thrombosis.
Yes, sir.
Then how do you clinically, it's evident to you?
I don't know, sir.
Okay, I'll give you a clue. You are looking at the anterior abdominal wall.
Yes,
there is thrombosis. Somehow the blood will want to bypass the thrombosis. So
yes,
are there any veins, superficial veins, that that are tributaries to the great saphenous vein that run over the anterior abdominal wall?
Okay.
Around umbilicus.
Below that.
Superficial epigastric.
Excellent. So
you know the answer. So you told he's having pain, right?
Yes, sir.
Why he is having pain? I say it is a diabetic neuropathy. He's a diabetic patient, and I say it's a diabetic neuropathic pain.
Yes, sir.
What do you think? Why is having pain? Is it because of varicose veins or some other reason?
Sir, because of varicose veins, sir.
Okay, varicose veins, pain. What is the relation between the pain and the duration? If a patient is having, one patient is having varicose veins since 1 year, like your patient, another patient has varicose veins since 10 years and with very big dilated veins, who will have more pain according to you?
Sir, can you repeat me, sir?
Yeah, there are two patients comes to you, yes, OPD, sir, on the same day, same time. One patient is having varicose veins since 1 year.
Yes, sir.
Little bit dilated veins. Another patient is having varicose veins since 10 years. And very large, big dilated veins are there. Now, who will have more severity of pain? It's inverse, okay? In the early periods, early duration, they will have more pain compared to the longer. Okay, there is no direct correlation between the pain and the duration of the varicose veins. That's just why I wanted to highlight that. Okay, it's inversely related. Now, if this patient had a ulcer, imagine that your patient had an ulcer.
Yes, sir.
Okay, varicose vein along with the ulcer. Let's put varicose ulcer. How will you treat that?
Sir, based on Biscard regimen.
Okay, what are this?
I will treat. In that, I will first reduce the edema and then elevation of limb and massage of limb and active and passive movements of limb. And then I will, if venous ulcer present means, I will clean the wound with the hydrogen peroxide.
No, what is the definitive treatment you didn't tell? One more, most important.
What does it need?
Split skin graft.
No. Antibiotics. For the ulcer to heal, there is some issue. What is causing the ulceration in the first place? Ma'am? Why does the patient with varicose veins develop a venous ulcer? What is the cause behind it? What is the pathophysiology?
Ma'am, chronic ambulatory hypertension present.
There is some issue with pressure, right? So how will you...
Yes, ma'am. I will apply elastic bandage.
Excellent. Okay.
So... you think first you will treat the ulcer or the varicose veins?
Sir, I will treat the ulcer first, then varicose
veins. You think ulcer will heal like that without treating the varicose veins? What is the cause for the ulcer? Without treating the root cause, what is the difference between venous ulcer and varicose ulcer?
Sir, venous ulcer is sloping ulcer. It's present in below one third of the leg, sir. It will present in sloping. It does not cross deep fascia, sir. But arterial ulcer, it's a punched out edge present.
No, the question was, Monisha.
Venous and varicose.
Varicose ulcer. Are they different? If they are different, how are they different? The question wasn't whether it is different from an arterial ulcer. The question was, what is the difference between venous ulcer and varicose ulcer? That is all.
Okay, no problem. I'll ask you a very basic question, Monisha. Can you please tell me the course of short saphenous vein?
Sir, short saphenous vein arises from a dorsal venous arch union with lateral marginal vein behind the lateral malleolus and runs upwards in posterior aspect, which is drains into popliteal veins, sir.
Okay, good. I have last two questions for you. Chandana, after you ask. One thing. Now, what operation you do for this?
Sir, Trendelenburg operation, sir.
Okay, and you may also even strip the vein. Stripping of the vein will be done, okay?
Yes, sir, stripping of the
vein. Plus ligation and stripping of the vein. When we strip the vein, we don't go all along the vein till the end, till the toe, till the ankle. Okay, we just end up just above the just below the knee or so. Why is it? Why you think so? What will happen? What is the what we are concerned about?
So recurrence and stuff, you know.
No, don't strip below the knee. That is his question.
Yeah, what will happen if we try to strip the vein below the knee? What we are, we can do. Okay,
yes,
but we are concerned about something. What is that?
The sural nerve involvement.
Great
sural
saphenous
nerve
vein.
Injuries. Great saphenous nerve involvement.
Okay. What is the treatment for DVT? The surgical treatment for DVT. You know, can you please mention some surgeries for DVT surgery?
Palmar surgery.
Very good. Very good.
And make.
May.
May what?
May Kasmi.
Very good. Wonderful.
Very nice.
Chandana?
Okay, excellent presentation, first of all. Can you tell me the answer to the question that sir was asking? Are varicose ulcer and venous ulcer different or are they the same?
Ma'am, they're different, ma'am.
How are they different?
Ma'am, they are arterial ulcer by ischemic changes.
No, ma'am? No, varicose and venous ulcer. Repeatedly is asking. You do not know me, say no.
Yes,
next question, Chandana.
The patient has come to you with varicose veins. He has very, very prominent veins. And before proceeding to surgery, you get an a duplex scan of the limb. And
yes,
it shows DVT. What will you do next? Will you operate?
No, ma'am. Contraindication, ma'am. Defined thrombosis contraindication.
Okay. Very good.
What will the how will you counsel the patient before the surgery?
Good afternoon, everyone. Today we are going to see a case scenario, that is, a 40-year-old female came with a complaint of prominent eyes for the past 1 year, which is seen with palpitations, nervousness, weight loss, in spite of good appetite, disturbed sleep, recurrent fever, diarrhea, oligomenorrhea, muscle weakness, probably involving the pathology of the thyroid gland. On general examination, the patient is conscious, coherent, oriented to time, place, and person.
Go to the local examination.
Examination of eyes. On examination, the eyeballs are prominent. The upper sclera is seen above the limbus. Infrequent blinking of eyelids is present. Lid lags behind. On asking the patient to look up and down, edema of the eyelids and conjunctiva is seen, and difficulty in everting the upper eyelid. Intentional tremors are present. Hands are warm and moist. No pretibial mixed edema, pruritus, palmar erythema, thinning of hair, dupuytren's contracture. No corneal or conjunctival ulcers. Local examination of neck. After taking consent, examination is done in front of the neck in the region of thyroid. On inspection, no visible enlargement in the thyroid region is present. No visible nodules. Surface appears to be smooth. Skin over the region of thyroid appears normal. No scar, sinuses, and dilated veins are present. No visible pulsations. Trachea appears to be in the midline position. On palpation, the swelling is warm, not tender. Mild diffuse enlargement of the thyroid gland is observed. Smooth surface is present. No nodules. And the swelling is soft in consistency. The swelling moves upon deglutition and does not move on protrusion of tongue. Lower border of the swelling is palpable, becomes more prominent on performing Pizzolo's method. Plane of the swelling is deep to deep fascia. Carotid pulsation is felt against the upper border of the thyroid cartilage, which is equal on both sides. No palpable thrill is present. Trachea is in the midline position. No other swellings are present. Coates test, no stridor is observed. On percussion, no retrosternal dullness is present. Auscultation, no breath is heard. Examination of lymph nodes, no palpable lymph nodes in the neck region. Other system examination appears to be good. My provisional diagnosis is a case of primary thyrotoxicosis with no complications.
Okay, what is thyrotoxicosis, Girish?
Thyrotoxicosis is a physiological manifestation of hyperthyroidism, sir.
Okay. So, can you please go back to the examination? How did you palpate for the isthmus?
Yes.
Palpation, you did know palpation?
Yes, sir. Lahes method.
Okay, what is that?
On standing behind the patient, placing the thumbs approximated, and pushing with one of the hand, we will push the thyroid.
That's for the lobes, on the other lobe. I'm asking about the isthmus. Isthmus connection between the lobes.
Don't know, sir.
Okay. Okay. I will read about that. And yeah, in normal people, it's not visible, not palpable. Okay, only in the from the front with two fingers, you'll press against the thyroid, and that's how you palpate for the isthmus. Where did you auscultate for the thyroid? In which part you auscultated?
Upper part of the thyroid gland, sir. And
why?
Because in thyroid toxicosis, in sometimes you can hear the systolic breath.
Why in upper pole, I'm asking?
What is there?
Why in upper pole? Why not in the lower pole or any somewhere else?
Upper pole is more closely related to internal carotid artery.
From the internal carotid? Come on. What is the
blood supply of thyroid?
What is the blood supply? Exactly.
Superior thyroid artery and inferior thyroid artery.
Which is the dominant artery among
superior thyroid?
It's inferior. But still you look for superior thyroid artery. Auscultation. Why? I'll give you all the clues.
What is the difference? How does the superior enter the thyroid? How does the inferior enter? Which one branches before it enters? Which is it?
Superior thyroid branch. Superior thyroid branches before it enters.
It does not branch. That's the point.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. These are the pakka questions for you. In thyroid, from any examiner will ask pakka questions. Okay. Telling.
Okay.
Next. Okay. How will you evaluate this patient now?
Evaluation, we'll see for thyroid profile, sir.
Mm-hmm.
On thyroid profile, we'll see the T3, T4 and TSH.
Mm-hmm. Now, TSH, T3, T4 is normal.
We'll look for any long-acting thyroid stimulating antibody suppression, sir. That is anti-TPO antibodies or THI. Next, we'll look for ultrasound, sir. Ultrasound of the neck. For any retrosternal extension is present or not. And
No, I'm asking. That's okay. T3, T4, normal. Still, can it be thyrotoxicosis?
Yes, sir.
TSH is low and T3, T4 is normal, within normal range. Can it be still thyrotoxicosis?
No, sir.
No?
No, sir.
It can be, because what we are concerned is free form of thyroid hormone, that is free T3 and free T4. Okay, that you should look for particularly in case of suspected thyrotoxicosis, not bound form. Bound form can be, bound form means what, Girish?
Right?
Bound.
What is bound form? What is free form? Okay, if you do this.
Good evening, everyone. I'm going to present a surgery clinical case. So here's the summary of my case. A 58-year-old male patient presented with a swelling in the right side of the neck since 6 years, which was insidious onset and gradually progressive. The swelling was not associated with pain, paresthesia, dysphagia, dyspnea, change in voice, cough, a loss of appetite, or significant loss of weight. And there was no history of similar swelling in our body, in other body parts. Patient had no history of trauma. Patient had no history of any disease such as hypertension, diabetes, and tuberculosis. So, since the physical examination was unremarkable, we will directly go to local examination. So, inspection. It was done in the sitting position with the sufficient exposure up to mid-sternum. The swelling was single, which was globular in shape, and it was present in the right supraclavicular region, posterior triangle of the neck. Swelling had a well-defined margin, and the skin over the swelling is normal. No movements with deglutition, and no scar and sinus was present, and there were no pulses seen. On palpation, temperature was normal. No, there was no tenderness. The size of swelling was 4 into 5 cm. There was smooth surface, well-defined borders, firm consistency, and horizontally mobile. It was below deep fascia, non-pulsatile and non-compressible swelling. All inspective findings were confirmed. So on percussion, dull note was over the swelling was seen. There was no auscultatory findings. There were no bruits and snow strider. No other lymph nodes were enlarged, and oral cavity we didn't see any growth or patch in oral cavity. Systemic examination was also unremarkable. So I have differential diagnosis in my case. It may be a cold abscess, lipoma, neurofibroma, or secondaries in the neck lymph nodes. We told the patient to get FNAC and MRI and routine blood tests. So routine blood test was also unremarkable. FNAC findings showed spindle cells, and MRI clearly showed.
No.
That's okay. No need. We'll only stick on to the clinical. Okay. We'll find it. You tell me the each differentials. Explain me why.
Okay.
Why it's cold abscess? Why you thought it's a cold abscess?
Sir, since this temperature of the sir, some disturbance is coming. Sir.
Yeah. One second, Chandana. Your mic is having some disturbance.
Is it okay now?
Okay, ma'am. Sir, since the temperature of the swelling was normal, so and there was no sign of inflammation, but and the cold abscess is also it is inflammatory, but the temperature remains normal, so that's why I thought of cold abscess, and it is present in the posterior triangle of the neck. Sir, for lipoma, I thought because it may be a deep lipoma which may be arising from a muscle, since it was also below the deep fascia of the patient. Neurofibroma, sir, because it is a horizontally mobile and firm in consistency. So, and secondary is in the neck lymph node, because neoplastic lesion, most of the neoplastic lesions form the secondaries in the neck.
Okay, what's the final diagnosis?
Sir,
among these four, leave about the investigation. Among these four, what do you think is the most probable diagnosis? One, if I ask you.
Sir, neurofibroma.
Why?
Sir, because it was in firm in consistency, and it is a benign lesion as suggested by the history of the patient.
Okay. No, not painful.
Not painful.
Okay. So, what's another thing? Another thing about in favor of neurofibroma.
It was a horizontally mobile swelling, that's why.
Okay, anything you are telling neurofibroma only. To become neurofibroma, what should be there?
So it should be arising from a nerve, peripheral nerve.
Okay, from where exactly? What is schwannoma?
Schwannoma, sir, it is benign tumor arising from a Schwann cells of a peripheral nerve or a nerve involving cranial nerve.
I say it's a lipoma still. I say it's a lipoma. What's the point against?
Sir, it should be freely mobile, but this swelling was not a freely mobile.
Chandana, you can remove your headset, I think.
Yeah. Chandana.
You can directly speak, because I think it's... Now it's fine. Fine, thank you.
So this swelling was not freely mobile.
Okay.
That's why.
Did you look for the entire body?
Yes, I looked for entire body, but I could not find any similar type of swelling also.
Okay. What you are looking for actually?
So I was looking for the multiple swelling, which may be in the case of lipoma or neurofibroma.
Now, what is that called?
So multiple swelling in case of neurofibroma is von Recklinghausen's disease.
If it's lipoma,
sir, I forgot about lipoma. Sir, single lipoma, it is Durkheim's disease.
Single what lipoma,
what is Durkheim's disease?
Ma'am, it is a single lipoma. I forgot. I think.
What if multiple sebaceous are there in the body? What is that condition called?
Sir, I don't know, sir.
You read only about the neurofibroma and comma?
Yes, sir. So I read, but little nervous, so I could not recollect.
No, we are not asking you anything tough or anything other than what you have written. Go back to the auscultation.
Yes, sir.
What have you written? No bruits, no stridor.
Sir, if the swelling is arising from any vascular aneurysm, then it may show some of pulsations. So altered pulsation like murmurs or bruits or stridor should be heard in this case.
What is stridor?
So stridor is... the breathing sound which comes on the deformity in the larynx.
Then you will where is the larynx?
Yes, sir.
Where is the larynx?
So in the neck, sir.
Where is the swelling?
It's in the posterior triangle.
Okay, so you put the radiation of sound in the posterior triangle from the larynx.
No, sir. Actually, we need to do auscultation only when there is a compressive pulses and inspectory findings should be there, then only we do auscultation. But I wrote it here.
Okay, not required, no?
No, not required.
You don't have anything to do with each other, do they?
Why did you do percussion on this swelling?
Sir, to know if there's a gaseous filled swelling or not.
What if it is gaseous filled? What is called? What it could be?
Sir, Brody's abscess.
Huh?
Or gas gangrene.
Gas gangrene?
In the neck?
Rigid, you're getting...
Laryngoseal.
Relax. Rajit, relax.
Laryngoseal. Okay.
Laryngoseal is correct. What is one, pathognomonic finding that you will see?
Laryngoseal will not go that laterally. Okay, it will be just lateral to the midline. It will be.
Assuming that see what will be, okay. What will be present?
Ma'am, please repeat the question. Sorry.
Classical finding in a laryngoseal?
Need a very, very, very lateral laryngoseal, which it is not. What is one finding that will be present?
Laryngoseal on palpation, what finding you will get?
Compressibility.
Okay, anything else? More?
Reducibility, compressibility.
What will it feel like?
Yes, ma'am.
What will a laryngoseal feel like?
Soft consistency.
Okay, please read about this, okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, one question from me. Your swelling is in the right posterior triangle, almost in the right supraclavicular region.
Yes,
if it
ma'am.
Was on the left side, would it change the implications in any way? You are not biased because you have not looked at the MRI reports or FNAC findings. This is a patient...
The same swelling would have been there on the left side. What you would have thought?
Yeah. So, what would you think about it? What would you look for?
I'm no clue. Sorry.
Same swelling. Left. Okay, I'll give you the clue. You tell me what is that? What is virtuous node?
Sir, lymph nodes.
Lymph node.
Yeah, it is a lymph node, correct? What is the specialty of Virchow's node?
Sir, not remembering.
So what's the treatment for this? Your neurofibroma. Okay, I said it's a schwannoma. What's the treatment now?
Sir, complete enucleation from the nerve fiber can be done, preserving the almost nerve there only.
Okay, what you'll counsel the patient? How will you counsel the patient before the surgery?
So I will tell him that it's a short surgery for the excision of this.
I'll do it in 1 minute. Don't worry. No, not that. But sir, so in the future, what can happen? Okay, does the surgery really required? All those things.
Sir, surgery is required, but it won't be going malignancy to a site of malignancy because it is a benign tumor. It may increase in size, but won't be going to the malignant site. But it is just like it won't good look on his body.
And another thing, if you do surgery, what is the possible complication? Or in the future, what may happen? Consequence?
Sir, nerve damage can be happen and loss of function of upper limb. Since it
and
is arising
high likely,
from...
the recurrence will be there. Okay, in this yes, case, sir. Step of in the same area or some other area of the body, they tend to have this, can get high prone for recurrence. All this lipoma and neurofibroma and all this, they're prone for, you should say that also. Okay.
Good evening to everyone and our judges. My name is Tanvi Sahani and I'm a final year medical student at MS Ramaya Medical College. Presenting the case of Mr. D, a 65-year-old...
Summary.
Sure, sir. So, just 1 second. Okay. So the patient presented with a swelling in the upper right upper neck of part of the neck since 8 years. He noticed a small size swelling in the right upper part of the neck just below the lower jaw, which was insidious in onset, and it progressed from a size of 2x2 to 6x6 to the present day. The swelling is not associated with any pain, redness over the skin, no history of trauma, no history of change in size of swelling before or after.
You can go
to
directly the
summary. Summary.
I'd asked you, to prepare that way. Yeah.
So here is a 65-year-old gentleman with a history of smoking who presented with a painless progressive swelling in the right submandibular region, which has progressed to approximately 3 times its size in the past 8 years, with no associated rapid changes in the size of the swelling. His general physical examination and vitals were normal. Coming to general examination, inspection right side, it is a solitary globular swelling measuring 5x5 centimeters in the right submandibular region, which presented approximately 2 centimeters below the margin of the lower jaw. Its extent superiorly just below the lower margin of jaw, medially 3 centimeters lateral to the midline, laterally 2 centimeters from the angle of the jaw and inferiorly 7 centimeters above the clavicle. The skin over the swelling was normal with no pigmentation, dilated veins, sinuses or scars, and no other swellings in the neck were noted. The left side was normal. On palpation, there was no local rise of temperature or tenderness. A globular 5 into 7 centimeter swelling was present in the right submandibular region with firm consistency, well-defined margins and a smooth surface. The swelling was mobile both horizontally and vertically. The skin over the swelling was pinchable and it was not adherent to any underlying structures. Oral cavity examination. The patient was able to open his mouth with 4 fingers, which was adequate. Misaligned teeth with lower jaw incisor were missing. Black patches were seen on the tongue. Cheek, gums, and retromolar trigone were normal with no discharging sinuses or pus from the floor of the mouth. Submandibular gland examination. On inspection, the Wharton duct opening was visible on either side of the frenulum with no redness or swelling and no discharging pus. Palpation, bimanual palpation showed that the gland was enlarged. There was no stone or any other swelling. Summary, a 65-year-old gentleman with a history of smoking presents with a painless progressive solitary globular swelling in the right submandibular region since 8 years, with firm consistency, smooth surface, and well-defined margins, which is not adherent to skin or the underlying structures, and there is no stone palpable in the Wharton's duct. My provisional diagnosis, it is a case of benign tumor of the right submandibular gland. And since the most common benign tumor of submandibular gland is pleomorphic adenoma, so it might be a case of pleomorphic adenoma.
In which gland pleomorphic adenoma is more common?
Sir, it is more common parotid gland. It is usually seen in the tail of the superficial lobe of the parotid, which is most common. But about 8 to 9%, it can also be found in submandibular.
I say this is a lymph node, submandibular lymph node.
Sir, on examination, we can differentiate whether it's the gland or the lymph node. So first point in favor of the gland is that it was bimanually palpable. That means I could palpate it intraorally from the lateral floor of the mouth.
How did it
and,
do?
Do you call it or something else?
Bidigital.
Okay. How did it do?
Sir, the index finger intraorally is put at the lateral floor of the mouth and the other hand we support the gland and we check whether the gland is enlarged or not.
Where did you exactly look for the Wharton's duct?
Sir, it is on both sides of the frenulum.
Both sides of the, okay, in the floor of the mouth?
Yes, sir. We asked the patient to elevate the tongue. The in midline, you'll see the frenulum and we see the opening on either side.
What about the Stenson's duct?
Sir, it is seen on the upper part of the cheek and it's opposite to the second molar tooth.
Okay, what are the points against sylentinitis? Because very common, chronic sylentinitis, very common in the submandibular glands.
Sir, first of all, this is a painless swelling. And if it was, there was a stone in it, it would have been painful, especially during chewing and also after food. And also the patient would have presented to us before. This is a very long history of painless growing mass. The patient would have presented to us sooner because there would have been pain associated. And on examination, the gland would have, it would be in hard consistency because of the stone. Even in the if it was in the duct also, we could have palpated a hard mass.
So your final diagnosis, confirmed diagnosis, it's a benign tumor of the submandibular gland.
Yes,
how will you manage this case?
So we will go ahead with an ultrasound guided FNAC to confirm the diagnosis. And if it's a pleomorphic adenoma, we would see a mix of epithelial and myoepithelial cell pathology. Now, since here we have no lymph nodes associated and just there's a benign pathology, I would go ahead with the submandibular gland excision.
Submandibular gland excision.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What is the role of radiotherapy in case of pleomorphic adenoma?
Sir, there is no role because this pleomorphic adenoma is said to be radio resistant. So there's no role of radiotherapy in
this
case.
Why would you want to excise the entire gland? Can you enucleate the tumor?
Ma'am, can there be chances of reoccurrence? I would like to do complete resection.
What are the possible complications? What are you concerned about during the surgery?
So during surgery, first I will talk about the nerves. So the incision has to be made at least 3 to 4 centimeters below the margin of the lower jaw to preserve the marginal mandibular nerve. That's during incision. And while resecting the gland, we have to be careful about hypoglossal nerve and sublingual nerve, because hypoglossal is present at the base of the gland. And
you are answering well. Let me, can I ask one question, sir?
Please.
What is, can you know what is rule of two in submandibular gland? No problem. Suppose there's
she knows. Tanvi, rule of two.
Sir, there are two lobes. There's a superficial and a deep lobe.
So two indications.
There are two submandibular glands, one on the left, one on the right.
Each.
Now, two indications, 2 centimeter, 2 finger breadth below, 2 inches length, 2 superficial nerves to preserve, two deep nerves to be preserved.
Yes, sir.
Two lobes
so the base
to be
easy,
removed,
remember.
And 2-point ligation of the facial artery.
Yes, sir.
One more question. If you answer this, you'll be, if there is a stone in the duct with relation to the lingual nerve.
Yes, sir.
How will you deal with it?
Sir, we have to... when the stone is present in the duct, we have to see two things, where the size of the stone and the position of the stone. So if the size of the stone is less than 4 mm, we go ahead with intraoral approach. And coming to the site, if it is proximal or distal to the lingual nerve, also we have to see. So if it is proximal, I think we have to incise the duct. And
distal.
There's MARD supinization kind of procedure where we remove the stone, we incise it and then...
Okay. Read it. No problem. Well done.
Nandana?
Sir, I have no questions. She did very well.
After the complications, I...
Tell me.
So nerves, and then we also have to... as sir already mentioned, the facial artery has to be ligated at least twice. And also, we have to take care of the facial vein while resecting the...
What are the signs of malignancy?
Sir, in this case...
What are the warning signs of malignancy?
Sir, though it will be a painless swelling, but it would mostly be accompanied with a rapid increase in size. And also, sir, because of the pressure effects... there can be adjacent structures can also be.
Okay.
Sir, on palpation, the gland would have been hard if it was malignancy.
Hmm.
And it would invade it into the other structures. There might have been change in voice.
What do you look for extra?
So the lymph nodes have to be checked. They would have been palpated. Induration would have been there. And if it were
skin
adhering to this, skin, there could have been fungation, ulceration,
perfect,
or
wonderful,
pressure necrosis.
Wonderful. Any role of chemotherapy or any?
Of chemotherapy in benign tumors, but if it was a pathology after resection of the tumor, we have to go ahead with the adjuvant chemotherapy, but not in benign.
What is your thought about FNAC, this parotid or submandibular gland? Doing FNAC, can we do?
Sir, in submandibular, yes, sir. Even in parotid, but if parotid FNAC is not giving us a definite answer, we go ahead with excisional biopsy. So in that, we would take hemi, the superficial hemi? Lobe of the superficial lobe.
What about the submandibular? Can we do open biopsy?
I'm not sure about this.
What are the problems with open biopsy?
Yesterday answered.
Sir, there can be seeding of the tumor cells.
Yeah, we can go. Yes,
or invading of the other structures.
One second, sir. I'm not. Yes.
It's okay. Take your time.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to present clinic case present case presentation in White Army. And I would like to, shall I start, sir?
Yeah, yeah.
A 68-year-old female, married female homemaker with obstetric score of P2L2 came with the complaints of lump in the left breast for past 6 months, which was insidious in onset, initially smaller in size, gradually progressed to attain the current size, discharged from left nipple for nature, not blood stain and or false milling, pain in the left breast for 10 days, diffused throughout the left breast, intermittent with no aggravating and relieving factors, without any ulceration, fungation and fissures, no significant past injury. No history of trauma.
Okay, you can, size, it's okay. Chronic, you can go to the
local examination.
Yes, sir. Local examination. After getting consent from the patient is exposed from neck till waist, examined under adequate lighting and privacy in the presence of a female attender. Inspection of the patient done in the sitting position with arms by the side. Left breast is larger than the right breast, asymmetrical, oval-shaped lump of size approximately 2 into 3 centimeters in the right upper quadrant, irregular surface with well-defined margin and skin over the breast. There is no dilated veins, abnormal pulsation, dimpling, puckering, retraction, podrange appearance, nodules, ulceration or fungation. Nipple areola complex is found to be normal in size and color, but there is a serous discharge seen from the nipple, from the left side nipple, which is not foul smelling and not blood stain. Inspection of the patient in
Shivashankari. We can't hear you.
The sitting position with leaning forwards falls equally on both the sides. Inspection of the patient sitting position with arms against the hip. Prominent lump is seen on the left breast. Inspection of the right breast is found to be normal. Palpation.
There seems to be some disturbance in the audio.
Yeah, we will read by ourselves.
Okay. Sir, is it okay?
Yeah, present. Yeah, it's visible. We can hear you, but there's some disturbance. Please continue.
Okay. Yes, sir. All inspectory findings are confirmed on palpation. A single limb, lump of 2 into 3 centimeters in outer quadrant of left breast, oval in shape, irregular surface with well-defined margin, hardened consistency, mobile, no abnormal pulsation is seen, and not fixed to overlying skin, mobile along the breast tissue, not fixed to underlying structures by keeping hand at the hip, not fixed to the chest wall by leaning forward, nipple areola complex is normal and serous discharge is seen. Examination of the lymph nodes is found to be axillary and supracapillary lymph nodes are not palpable. And opposite breast and axilla is normal. Supracapillar fossa is normal. Other system examination is normal. Do I have to?
No,
it's normal. Summary and provisional diagnosis. A 68-year-old lady with lump in the outer quadrant of left breast, 2 to 3 centimeters. Irregular surface, hardened consistently, mobile without any skin changes, just for involvement, ulceration, fungation. Presence of nipple discharge with serous in consistency, not blood stain or foul smelling. Most likely to be carcinoma of breast of left side with staging of a T2, N0, M0 of stage 2, A, which is an early breast cancer stage. So.
Good. So for exams, what you do is better in exam in your paper, write one schematic diagram. Always better, gives a good impression. Okay.
Okay,
put a schematic diagram of the breast. And how many quadrants are there in the breast?
Four quadrants, sir.
Okay.
Four quadrants, yes, sir.
Which is the fifth quadrant?
Sir?
Which is the fifth quadrant?
The...
Logical. What's left out?
Nipple.
Middle, central, what is that?
Central.
Nipple area complex.
Nipple area complex.
Complex. Okay. Why? In your case, which quadrant has the tumor?
Upper outer quadrant, sir.
And yeah, in which quadrant the tumor is more common?
Upper outer quadrant is more
Why?
Common. Because there's dense tissues seen in the upper outer quadrant, sir.
What else could be there? I say it is a enlarged axillary tail of Spence.
Sir?
I say, let's say, you know axillary tail of Spence?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I say it's an enlarged axillary tail of Spence. Which is normal. You have anything against me? Because no lymph nodes palpable, nothing. Only one lump is there.
Yes, sir.
I say this is a normal variant of axillary tail of Spence. Why you say it is a carcinoma of breast?
Sir, first of all, the age of, we'll start from the age of the patient. She's a postmenopausal lady. And also, there is no history suggestive of benign conditions such as like fibroadenoma, like fibroadenoma, since she's in a, she's a married and she's having all obstetric score of P2L2. So, fibroadenoma.
Okay, you tell me, it is carcinoma. What are the points in favor of carcinoma?
Yes, sir. There is a presence of serous discharge is seen. And also, in when we come to the examination part, we are finding a hard, hard irregular surface with well-defined margin lump is seen in the upper outer quadrant, sir.
Can you tell me the different types of discharges, nipple discharges in case of breast?
Yes, sir. Milk discharge in case of galact.
Where else you'll get the serous discharge?
And serous discharge, will we can...
what other conditions?
Don't get tense. If you can say, I do not know, or say you're going good.
No, you know the answer.
Hmm.
What other conditions you can get with the nipple mastite retraction and serous discharge?
Mastitis.
Mastitis. Okay, next.
And abscess, chronic abscess.
Hmm.
And then.
Okay.
Ductectasia.
Okay. Yeah. What are the skin changes you expect here in the breast, CA breast?
Podrange appearance, satellite nodules, and ulceration, fungation in cases of.
Okay. If there was a supraclavicular lymph node,
yes, sir,
how the staging would have changed?
What is
staging? If there was a
advanced stage, sir.
Okay. What is the staging? N, what is that? Supraclavicular lymph node. Belongs to which N category?
Sir?
Supraclavicular lymph node belongs to which category?
Advanced category, sir?
No, in TNM staging.
TNM, oh, yes, sir. Three, most probably 3B, sir. Stage 3B, sir.
No, stage E. I'm asking N category, particularly N category, which to which... Okay, anyway, TNM staging is very important in a case of breast. Okay, at least they can be asked in theory also. It can be asked in theory also to write the TNM staging of the CA breast. Chandana, your questions.
Okay. Suppose this patient had puckering or dimpling. How would you explain it?
In that case, that means the... there is infiltration in the ligament of Cooper, and due to which the there is a traction, there is a dimpling. Those fibers are pulling the breast towards inward. That's why we
are having. What are the attachments of ligaments of Cooper? Where are they attached to?
Ligaments of Cooper is attached to.
Anteriorly to what? Posteriorly to what?
To what? Okay, that's all right.
Can you tell me the lymphatic drainage, the breast?
Lymphatic drainage, axillary lymph node to the anterior axillary lymph node, central, pectoral.
What are the other? What is the other lymph node group draining the breast in addition to axillary?
Supraclavicular lymph nodes.
Before that?
Mediastinal.
No. It has the name of the breast in it, right? Which is the chain of lymph nodes which receives close to 20% of lymphatic.
Rotus. Inner quadrant.
Rotus.
What is rotor lymph node?
Okay. Since you brought us to it.
We should ask what they know. What is rotus lymph node?
Rotus lymph node is the lymph node between pectoralis major and the pectoralis minor.
Which Burke's level it belongs to? You know, Burke's levels?
Yes, sir. Level 1,
1 2, 3.
Yes, sir. Level 1 and 2, 3.
No, Rotter's lymph node belongs to which group? Level 1, 2 or 3?
Sir, it is it's a retrograde. Level.
What is sentinel lymph node biopsy?
Sir, sentinel lymph node biopsy is like the first, the tumor, tumor that first lymph node that has been infiltrated is set up in our sentinel lymph node, and we'll be doing the sentinel lymph node biopsy in order to find whether there is a lymphatic spread.
Is there or not? Okay. What is skip metastasis?
So skip metastasis.
What is skip metastasis?
I don't know, sir. I don't
okay, leave, no problem. Okay. Okay. Anything else? Treatment part you want to ask, Chandana? Any surgery? Okay, what surgery you will do here for early breast cancer?
Sir, for early breast cancer, we'll be going for breast conservative surgery, sir.
What are the prerequisites?
For the prerequisites, is like we need to check whether the lump, breast lump size and the tissue size ratio. And if there is any multicentric or multifocal.
What is multicentric? What is multifocal?
Multicentric is basically the quad, the lymph node, the lymph node infiltration will be there in different quadrant. In multifocal will be.
Right?
Tumor. With respect to quadrants.
Quadrant. And for 5 centimeter distance in between the same.
That's also a good definition. Okay. It's given only 4 centimeters given, no? As I remember.
Yes, sir. 4 centimeters, okay. Sir. 4 centimeters.
4 centimeters. Okay. Or else if it's in a different quadrants, it's called multicentric. If it's in the same quadrant, it's multifocal.
Multifocal.
Good. But okay. Well, finally, the patient is not willing for the breast conservative surgery. Okay. She can't come for radiotherapy regularly. Okay. And then she's worried about the recurrence and all. What will you do now? Next.
Sir, we'll go for hormonal therapy. Like aromatase inhibitors. And since she's a postmenopausal woman, we can go for aromatase inhibitor.
Surgery? You don't want to do surgery?
Conservation, because she thinks it will recur if you conserve the breast. What will you do?
What other options you have?
We can, like surgery is like MRM, we can go modified radical mastectomy.
What is Auchincloss MRM?
Auchincloss MRM is basically, we'll be preserving level 1 and level 2 lymph nodes, axillary lymph nodes. Sir.
What is remote? Tell us that first.
The breast, the lump tissue, the tissues and the...
Yes. So good evening, all of you. And first of all, I want to thank you for giving me such a wonderful opportunity to present. So I'm going to present. And my name is Sapna Shah. I'm from PDU MC Rajkot. So a 24-year-old, low socioeconomic class female, resident of Rajkot, presented with chief complaint of left breast lump since 10 days, associated with chest pain since 3 days, back pain since 3 days, and left upper limb swelling since 3 days. No history of nipple discharge or ulcer over the breast, weight loss or trauma or fever or irradiation or breathlessness. No history of nausea, vomiting, pain in abdomen, headache, seizure, yellow discoloration, abdominal pain, or hemoptysis or any drug intake or OCP or drug allergies. Presently non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, no history of medical or surgical intervention. Menarche at 13 years, and her cycle was regular of 4 to 5 days duration with adequate flow. No obstetric history, and she was unmarried. Her sister was diagnosed 1 year ago with breast cancer on the left side, for which mastectomy was done and medications were given. No other significant family history of ovarian cancer or endometrial cancer or gastrointestinal cancer. On general examination, a patient was examined in proper daylight.
Yeah, go to the local examination.
Sure, sir. A local examination, a patient was examined in proper light with proper exposure till waist. On inspection, patient was examined on sitting, semi-recumbent position, recumbent and forward bending position. Sitting position, the patient was examined with hands by the side of the body, arms raised above her head and hands on her hip, pressing and relaxing. In comparison to the right side, left breast was smaller in size and laterally and upwardly deviated, which we can appreciate in the picture, which was asymmetrical in shape with restricted movement of the left breast.
Smaller in size or bigger in size?
Smaller in size in comparison to the right side, sir.
Okay.
Okay. in shape with restricted movement of the left breast on forward bending on an raising arm upward with single approximately 15 into 10 centimeter lump of irregular margins and shape involving all the four quadrants with redness of overlying skin, no active discharge on left side sided breast, no engorged veins noted, no ulceration or scar or dimpling was noted. Nipple in comparison to the right nipple, left sided was normal in size with displays laterally and upward. Circumferential retraction was noted without ulceration, pigmentation, and cracks of fissures. Areola in comparison to the right side, left breast areola was normal in shape without any pigmentation, ulceration, or darkening. Upper limb in comparison to the right, left upper limb was edematous. On supine position, she had a single swelling of approximately 15 into 10 centimeter, ill-defined shape involving all the four quadrants of the left breast with nipple areola complex involvement, with redness of the overlying skin, retraction present, no visible engorged vein, no dimpling, puckering of overlying skin was noted. So as you can see, the right breast Okay. On palpation, the patient was examined on sitting and recumbent position. A single approximately 15 into 10 centimeter size, ill-defined shape, palpable swelling present in the left side, left breast involving all the four quadrants with well-defined margins, raised overlying skin temperature, firm in consistency, fixed to the underlying muscles and chest wall. No fixity, overlying skin, no active discharge from bilateral nipple areola complex. Upper limb examination, left upper limb sensation were present, power was reduced, and right breast had no abnormality was noted. This is the video to show the nipple discharge.
Okay. It's okay, we'll go next. Nipple discharge is okay. Fine.
Nice videos, ma. But
yeah, we'll have a separate case presentation by her. Detailed presentation we'll have.
Means time limit exceeds means the other students will feel.
Yeah. Okay. No, so we'll have a separate session by you. It's a detailed long case.
What is your diagnosis? Then the examiners will take over because the time limit is there.
Okay.
Other students be stopped. Okay.
Okay.
What is your come to your diagnosis? The examiners will take over.
Inflammatory.
Okay. So, provisional diagnosis is left-sided inflammatory breast cancer with lymph node involvement and probably metastasis, that is T4D, N1, and M1.
Okay. First of all, why you say it's inflammatory breast cancer?
So, I have prepared this slide for that. So, can I show that?
No. You answer me.
Sure, sir. This is inflammatory breast cancer. First of all, it can be... this is a very short duration
of inflammatory breast cancer.
Sorry,
what are the criteria?
That's what I'm saying. First of all, it is rapid onset and it is rapidly progressive. There is at least more than one third of redness and red erythema is present, and less than 6 months of history is present, and it is rapidly progressive. So we can say that it is inflammatory breast cancer.
Could you feel that mass separately from the breast tissue, or it was entire breast tissue was involved? Almost you said 15 centimeter and 10 centimeter.
Yes, entire breast tissue was involved.
So how sure you are it's a separate lump or mass? It could have been just a hardened breast tissue. I say this is a mastitis.
Yeah, so if it was mastitis, sir, then there would be some discharge. Here there is no discharge. And,
need not be. Why discharge will be there in mastitis?
Because mastitis is infection, and this is an inflammatory process. An infection, discharge of pus may be present in mastitis. So,
please keep note that it is not mandatory for that to be present. And what are the other features that you should look for to defend? How would you better answer this question? Because that is not a constant feature. Discharge may not be present. People with even people with breast abscesses who come to you not present with discharge. So
okay, ma'am. The patient had complaint of chest pain and back pain as well. So,
a significant feature in history. This patient had a sister who had.
Yes, ma'am. Sorry, ma'am. She had a sister, and she had a significant family history. Who she had breast cancer. So, that can be a possibility. Like it deviates towards inflammatory breast cancer more.
Why you look for all the other? Why did you ask for ovarian cancer, endometrial cancer, and other things?
So it can be because she had family history. It can be related to BRCA, BRCA 1 and 2, and with that they have like if the family has ovarian, breast cancer, endometrial cancer, and breast cancer, it's common. So that could be a possibility. Hello.
In your patient, assuming that she has inflammatory breast cancer, if you were to do a biopsy, what is the pathognomonic feature that will suggest that it is inflammatory breast cancer?
If I do biopsy?
Yes. Are there any specific histological markers for inflammatory breast cancer?
I don't know, ma'am. Sorry.
Okay. So what you typically see in inflammatory breast cancer is something called lymphatic permeation. So you see a tumor emboli in the lymphatics. So that is a pathognomonic feature of inflammatory breast cancer.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
What is primary? What is secondary? Inflammatory breast cancer. What is primary inflammatory breast cancer? What is secondary?
I'm sorry, sir. I don't know.
What was evident of M1? You have written M1. What was the evident metastasis clinically?
Clinically, she had back pain, and that's why she could have lumbar and.
Where is the most common metastasis to? From
lumbar vertebra and thoracic vertebra.
Why? Junction? Thoracolumbar junction. Why? More common? What is it? Venous plexus?
Sir, I forgot the name.
Okay, fine. N1, which lymph node was involved?
Sorry, sir. It was not N1. It was N3. My mistake. It was axillary and supraclavicular lymph nodes are involved. So it's not N1. It's okay. N3.
The patient had a swollen right upper limb, right? Why was the right upper limb swollen?
No, not right. In comparison to right, left upper limb was swollen.
Why?
Because the lymph nodes were blocked. So the lymphatic drainage was not possible, because of which it leaded to a left limb got swollen.
Okay, so lymphedema. Treat this patient for her inflammatory breast cancer and she's in remission. And then she turns up with later, 10 years later, she turns up with a hard left upper limb with nodules all over. What are your systems?
Stewart-Tross syndrome. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right because of.
You can tell in common language. You need not syndrome. It's what is commonly called, you can tell.
Okay.
Complication of lymphedema. What is that?
Yes. While doing the mastectomy, modified radical mastectomy, we remove the lymph nodes. And because of that, later, because when we remove the lymph nodes, the lymphatic drainage is not...
No, madam is asking specifically, what is that condition called? One word answer.
The disease.
Lymphangio?
Yes.
Lymphangio what? What do you call a malignant tumor of connective tissue?
I forgot the name.
Lymphangiosarcoma. That's okay. Happen. Okay. Lymphangiosarcoma. Yes. What's the treatment? What do you do now for this? Planned management?
So, here we'll give either hormonal hormonal therapy. If she is ERPI positive, then we'll give hormonal therapy. If she is premenopausal, we will give... SERM, that is tamoxifen, and later when the sorry, ma'am,
is hormonal the first thing that you give her? She has inflammatory breast cancer and this is probably metastatic, as you say. Hormonal follows what?
Chemotherapy, ma'am.
Yeah, so that is at the fore. Hormonal therapy and say if you have to give targeted therapy for a HER2 new mutation, that always has to follow chemotherapy. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
Okay, this osteoporosis is there because of that bone involvement. What will you give treatment? Calcium absorption is there.
Bisphosphonate will be given to the patient and a calcium supplement would be given to the patient.
Okay, good. Good, mm-hmm. Well done. Click the next slide on the sides. For every slide, you have to click on the side.
Sir, right now, sir?
Yeah, now, okay. Huh.
Summary of the patient's history. A 47-year-old female homemaker patient, Mrs. Sudha, with no underlying comorbidities, presented with insidious onset of swelling of veins in the inner aspect of both her legs for the past 10 years. Patient noticed the swelling along the vein, which initially started in the lower leg and gradually progressed to the lower third of the thigh. The swelling aggravated on walking and standing for prolonged hours and relieved on lying down with both the legs raised. There was no associated pain, discoloration along the course of the vein, no intermittent claudication, non-healing ulcers, itching, edema of the ankle or foot noticed, no history of usage of elastic stockings, or she was not on oral contraceptive pills. Positive family history where maternal grandmother had similar complaints. General examination, the patient was conscious and well-oriented to her surroundings. She was moderately built.
Okay, we can go to the local examination.
The patient was very cooperative and consent was obtained before proceeding to the lower limb examination. Inspection, she was examined in the standing position from anterior, posterior, lateral and medial views. Findings on inspection of both the lower limbs, there is a tortuous dilated non-pulsatile vessel in the medial aspect extending from the upper two-third of the calf region till the lower one-third of the thigh region. There is no dilatation of the short saphenous system. There is no ankle flare, no saphena varix, no dilated veins over the abdomen. The vein collapses when the leg is raised. The skin is not pigmented or scaly. There is no oozing, no ulceration, no edema or deformity of the ankle or the foot, no swelling in the calf region. The following are pictures. This is from the posterior view. This is the left leg medial view. And this is the right leg medial view. Next is palpation. No local rise of temperature, no tenderness over the vein. It is collapsible, no cord-like thickening or nodules along the vein. The first test I performed was Grudy tendon Leber test. The veins are getting dilated when the tourniquet is kept tight below the saphenous opening. Also, on releasing the tourniquet, there is no further filling from above. Hence, positive, negative in both the limbs. Multiple tourniquet test shows incompetency of the above knee perforator, below knee perforator, lower leg perforator, that is 15 and 10 centimeter in the left leg. Whereas in the right leg, there is only incompetency of the below knee perforator. Perthes test was negative in both the legs. Modified Perthes test when performed was also negative. Next was Schwartz test. No impulse felt on the saphenous opening in both the legs. Prague's test was performed. Blowouts are noticed in the region of above knee, below knee and leg perforators. Again, 15 and 10 centimeter in the left leg. Whereas in the right leg, blowout was noticed only in the below knee perforator. Morrissey's cough impulse test, negative in both the legs. Feagin's method to indicate the site of perforators, positive. Gaps were felt again in the above, below knee and leg perforator. In the left leg, whereas in the right leg, only in the below knee pits could be felt. Moses and Homan sign was also performed, but it was negative. Percussion Schwartz test tapped on the most prominent part of the varicosity, but no impulse could be felt at the saphenous opening. Auscultation was not performed. Regional lymph nodes were not palpable. No abdominal lump was palpable. Provisional diagnosis, primary uncomplicated varicosities of the right long saphenous system in both the lower limbs with incompetency of the above knee, below knee and lower leg perforators, 10 and 15 and 10 centimeters in the left leg and only the below knee perforator in the right leg, without any clinical evidence of deep vein thrombosis. The CEAP classification is C2A, EP, AP and PR.
Very good, very good, very good. Okay. In exam, I have some advice for you, okay, before starting this thing.
Yes.
See, when you both the legs are included like this, you can make a box, like for especially for the tests and all.
Okay,
for tests you're written, instead of writing in a paragraph like that, you make up a box, three columns, okay. In one, you write the test name, in the right leg, what is the finding? Next, in the left leg, what is the finding? You can write, okay, that would be better than just like a, it's a very confusing. You have made a kind of, like, show me the last slide, there is a mistake.
Yes, sir.
What is that?
The provisional diagnosis, I wrote both as left leg. One is right.
Primary uncomplicated varicosities of the right long saphenous system. In both the lower limbs means?
In both the right and the left leg.
How can it be right long saphenous in both the right and left?
Long saphenous system in both. Okay, right.
That's why we should read whatever we write.
Okay.
Again. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Huh? So, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Why this, why you think, why did you look for the, why did you palpate for the varicose veins? You told us something, there is no, what is it? Go back to the slide, yes, palpation. No, there is cord. No cord-like thickening or nodules along the vein.
So I wanted to rule out superficial thrombophlebitis because in those cases, there will be cord-like thickening and nodules. So before a I just wanted to rule out so that that won't interfere with our final diagnosis. Cord-like thickening is very prominent if she is suffering from superficial